Simon & Schuster Audio presents A Quiet Life, a novel, by Ethan Joella. Read by Stacey Glemboski, Melissa Redmond, and Byron Wagner. For my mom, Jerry, who read to me and sketched pictures I will never forget. I am living. I remember you. Marie Howe, What the Living Do. Remember, no man is a failure who has friends. It's a Wonderful Life. Chapter 1. When Chuck Ayers thinks about Cat, he thinks about the faded yellow and white striped towel that lately he has been wearing around his neck like a wrestler on his way to a match. That damn towel. She used it for every bath. The towel hanging over the linen closet door to dry afterward. The smell of her pink soap as he walked by. And when they drove those hundreds of miles to Hilton Head every winter, she took the towel along, and it became her beach towel. Even as she got older, there was something alluring about the way she draped that towel around her body or shook it out over one of the lounge chairs at the pool in South Carolina. What can he do with this towel now? This towel he should have buried with her. This towel that he sleeps with some nights. This towel that hangs there, that stays wherever he leaves it. He should fold it and put it into a box on a high shelf in the closet with the word towel written on it so he never forgets, so he never opens it again, so he never remembers her holding the towel over her arm, so naive, unaware that the towel would outlast her, that she'd never have a chance to donate it, to tear it into cleaning rags, to use it to protect something in the attic, an antique lamp, an old mirror. He is glad for a second that it didn't come to that, that she got to use the towel fully and without stop. And that is the first thing in forever he has been glad for. December 29, late in the afternoon, and the sun is going down. The quiet street is shadowed and darker outside the windows. Instinctively, Chuck lights the small ceramic Christmas tree and switches on the front porch light. He looks out the window and notices all the other houses. He imagines good smells of dinners, random sounds of family, someone calling up the steps, the surge of a dishwasher running, dice from a board game, wine glasses clinking. He looks around his living room. Cat's painting of a river and trees hangs over the blue sofa. The dim floor lamp stands next to the chair in the corner, her basket beside it with word searches and Sudoku, and he remembers how alive the holidays used to feel. Even well into their 60s, Cat insisted on cutting down a tree every year. He pretended to object, but he didn't really mind because he liked walking through a field with her. Didn't care what tree they finally decided on, as long as he was physically able to saw it, drag it, as long as neither of them twisted their ankles in all those groundhog holes that seemed to be everywhere at the tree farm. He liked watching Cat's eyes when the children were younger, holding Ben and Leela's hands, looking so proper in her wool coat and leather gloves. "Oh, I think we found our candidate," she'd say, and the kids would clap because she made everything fun. Cat was the glue. She was the ringleader of every occasion. When they'd get home, she would be the one with Christmas music on the record player, a plate of cookies for the kids. She cherished each ornament as she removed it from the box, finding just the right tree branch for its weight. He crosses his arms, looks at the spot in the corner where the tree used to stand. He used to have so many feelings about the year ending, the winter ahead, the hope of the new year. Now he just feels guilt, and his guilt spreads everywhere. He feels guilty that the woman who delivers his newspaper in her noisy car waved to him through the window this morning, and he didn't wave back in time. He feels guilty because he saw lumber at Ace Hardware the other day and remembered Leela and Ben used to beg him to build a treehouse, and he meant to, but they grew up before he ever did. He feels guilty for all the guys who didn't make it back from Vietnam. Why did Chuck survive? And so much guilt about Cat. As if he's in a supermarket of guilt, and his carts overflowing. What should he do about the rental in Hilton Head? He stands in the kitchen the next morning. On the table, he sees the listing agreement, prepaid, and check-in information on a small blue card. They included the parking pass for the condo association, too. But all that anticipation he used to feel, the tease of warm weather and long days and the pool and the ocean, is gone. Christmas came and went, and it was such a quiet, uneventful day. Now, instead of that excitement of going south in mid-January, instead of his and Kat's 15-year tradition of driving the 12 or so hours with a car packed with luggage and groceries and cleaning supplies and that faded beach blanket, he doesn't know what to do. He thought the holidays would be the hardest. He didn't know the ultimate challenge, the boss battle, his granddaughter Gabby would call it, is Hilton Head, the island where he and Kat felt most alive. How can he need to be there so much right now and never want to see the place again, both at the same time? Can he go there without her? Does he want to be there without her? Can he stay here for the endless Pennsylvania winter that's just beginning? He wants to rip up the agreement. He wants Hilton Head to be gone, too, because Kat's gone, and he assumed that they had at least 10 more years to keep doing this. They had argued over what the other one would do when one of them died, but they never discussed Hilton Head. I want to go first. No, I want it to be me. I just don't want to live without you, one of them always said. Now Sal's at the door. Chuck can tell from the fast, single-knuckled rap. Ever since Kat died, Sal comes over more often, brings his dog with him. He has never asked, just lets Coco's leash drop when Chuck opens the door. The dog walks right past him and settles in the living room. Chuck says nothing, but the whole act frustrates him. Why didn't Sal ever bring Coco before? Why does he make it seem as if Kat prevented the dog from visiting? As if Kat wouldn't have stooped down to rub the dog's belly and used a squeaky voice when she talked to Coco. Chuck was lucky if he saw Sal once a month in the past, either at the barber's or Sal would drop by for car wax or to borrow the drill. Now he's here several times a week. How goes it? Sal asks, his once dark hair messy and grayed, Coco looking up at Chuck. Wait, Chuck says. He pops into the kitchen and returns with a small box of biscuits. He was at the market yesterday and bought them, the way someone might buy lollipops for grandkids. He shakes them. Here, girl. Hang on, Sal says. I should see the ingredients. They're dog biscuits. Yeah, but the vet said she has to watch. They're standard goddamn dog biscuits. Chuck half glares at Sal, and Sal just shakes his head and makes the go-ahead motion as he pulls out a dining room chair and plops down. What are you even doing here? Chuck wants to ask. Know-it-all Sal, who lives five houses down. A retired mailman. A guy whose kids ran in the same circles as Chuck's kids. In band together, on the swim team together. Kat and Sal's wife, Marguerite, were close. And maybe Marguerite urges Sal to come over and keep an eye on him. Want coffee? Chuck says as Coco takes two biscuits and goes back to her usual spot. He sits on the chair by her and rubs her head. He always wanted a Labrador like this, but he hated the puppy stage, which led them to usually adopt older rescues. Sal looks around. Got decaf? Yeah. Then sure. He looks over. She likes her chin rubbed. Sal pulls out a handkerchief and blows his nose. When are you heading south? Good question, Chuck says, and shrugs. Chuck looks into Coco's small, dark eyes. He wonders if he should get another dog. He saw a commercial for a nice local shelter called Rescue Ranch, but the prospect feels like throwing a small stone in a lake. Then his mind circles back to Hilton Head. The people walking dogs, their pace slow and welcoming. All the folks riding bikes, the pine trees, the golf carts. The pancake house where he and Kat would have breakfast once a week. The alligators sunning themselves everywhere that Kat used to sketch in her book. He pauses for a moment and thinks about how they worried about alligator attacks. They were always careful and kept their eyes open. But now He would almost welcome being dragged into the water, wouldn't he? No, he thinks, he wouldn't. I don't hear the coffee, Sal says after a minute. Chuck turns out all the lights as he walks to his bedroom. He sighs and looks at their long dresser. The bedroom is dim, so he turns on a lamp. Leela has been planning to come home so they can start going through Kat's things, and the thought of this crushes him. It hasn't been that long, has it? Just since May. He thinks he should go through her things first. Leela can be reckless, bagging up a whole drawer at a time without feeling, and he wants to have a moment with Kat's stuff before it's in a bin.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.